One evening, a little girl was kneeling by her bedside to say her prayers. Her mom knelt next to her on the left, her grandma to the right. The little girl began to pray like this: God, bless my mommy and my grandma and me and my little brother and Oscar, her cat. Help me at school tomorrow. Help us all to get a good night's sleep tonight. And then she began to shout in her prayer: and please be sure to remember to get me a bicycle for my birthday. Her mom said, honey, you don't have to shout. God is not deaf. Her little girl said, I know, but grandma is. She had it all figured out. Grandma was going to be God's instrument to answer her prayer. Over the course of a lifetime, we pray a lot of prayers. Wouldn't it be a shame to go through life lifting all kinds of prayers, but never get round to asking for the things that we most need? And what might those things be? Jesus tells us. There came a point in Jesus' ministry when his disciples apparently were feeling like there was something lacking in their prayers. And so they said to Jesus, Luke 11:1, Lord, teach us to pray. According to Luke, that was the question that prompted Jesus to then give us the words of what we call today the Lord's Prayer. Embedded in this prayer are four great petitions, four things that Jesus teaches us to ask for. So we can assume that these must be, in the mind and heart of Jesus, the four most important things that we should pray. Last week, we began by looking at the first petition. Thy will be done. Because you see, if God is our heavenly Papa, as Jesus teaches us to refer to God in this prayer, if God is our heavenly Abba, that means God loves us more than we love ourselves and wants only the best for us. And if God is all wise and all knowing, when it comes down to it, in the final analysis, do I really want what I want, or would I rather have what God wants for me? Yes, the Bible encourages any situation to tell God what we're hoping for. But Jesus models for us in the Garden of Gethsemane. Don't stop there. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said, if it's possible, let this cup of suffering pass from me. That's what he wanted. But he went on to say, nevertheless, not what I want, but you want. Because Jesus knew God's plan, God's way is better. When we get to a place in our lives where we can genuinely pray that prayer, not what I want, but what you want, thy will be done. Oh, finally, our spirit is free. We can lay down all that striving and trying to control what we can't control and simply focus on embracing what is and partnering with God to make the most of it. This is the first great petition. Thy will be done. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He goes on to give us three additional petitions. Today, we're going to look at petition number 2 and 3. And then next week, we'll wrap up with the fourth petition. Let's ask for guidance. Jesus, you came to show us the way, the truth, and the life, including the way we should pray. There are so many different things we need, and we ask so many things of you. But we also have blind spots in our prayers. Sometimes we don't know what we should pray. Fill in those blind spots for us. Lord, teach us to pray. We ask in your holy name, the powerful, wonderful, beautiful name of Jesus. Amen. So, as we well know, the prayer begins this way. Our Abba, our Papa, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, petition number one, on earth as it is in heaven. Then, verse 11, comes the second great petition. Give us this day our daily bread. Now, I don't know about you, but I've often found that second petition to be kind of underwhelming, almost simplistic, kind of a throwaway line. Because let's face it, for the vast majority of us here today, we have never once, a single day in our life, wondered if we would have enough food to eat. And so when we come to this part of the prayer, yes, we say the words, but probably most of us, it probably doesn't really resonate with us. But remember, when Jesus originally gave us this prayer, he was speaking to first century people, 85% of whom were peasants who lived at the subsistence level. And so the single greatest source of stress in their life on a daily basis was whether there was going to be enough for them and their family to eat. So what Jesus is modeling for us in this second petition is that whatever is the greatest source of stress in your life right now, ask for God's help with that. What is the single greatest source of stress in your life right now? Somebody tell me. Just call it out. The single greatest source of stress in my life right now is? What was it over here? Health. I heard one over here. Job. Somebody said, my kid.
Finances.
Yeah. Money, finances. What was that?
Studying.
The stress of school. And the list goes on and on. There are so many things to worry about in life. I heard somebody the other day refer to their head as their, quote, anxiety goblet. I thought that's a vivid word picture, right? My cup overfloweth with worry and anxiety. A husband said to his wife, why do you always worry about everything? It doesn't help. Oh, yes, it does, she says. 90% of the things I worry about never happen. What is it that is most stressing you out in your life right now? Maybe it's, as someone said, health. Or maybe it's caring for a sick loved one. Or a child who has special needs. Maybe it's whether I'm going to make ends meet and be able to pay the bills this month. Maybe it's your relationship or lack thereof. Or maybe it's a relationship that is broken with a spouse, a friend, or a coworker. Or maybe the stressor that haunts you from day to day is whether Gilligan and the Skipper 2, the millionaire and his wife, the movie star, the professor and Marianne will ever make it off that stupid island. There are so many things to worry about in this life. And in this, our Lord's Prayer, Jesus is inviting us, encouraging us, to bring to God the single greatest stressor in our life and to ask for help with that. But not just that, and this is the great insight that Jesus offers us with that second petition. Jesus isn't just teaching us in this second petition to ask for God's help with whatever is the greatest stressor in our life. He's teaching us to ask for help with that stressor in a very specific way. Because notice, the words that he teaches us to pray are not just, give us our bread. No, the words are, give us today our daily bread. In other words, he's teaching us to look at it in bite-sized daily chunks. In other words, he's encouraging us to ask God for whatever we most need today to help with the greatest source of stress in our life. Or to put it more precisely, he's encouraging us to ask God to help us figure out what we can and should do today to address the single greatest stressor in life, and then to ask for the strength to do that and to leave the rest to the future, to leave the rest to tomorrow. Why is that so important? Let me give you an example. Right now in my life, my single greatest source of stress is getting our house and my dad's house ready to go on the market for sale. As many of you know, my dad, 91 years old, shouldn't be living alone anymore. He's finally agreed to move in with us, but doesn't want to move into our space, so we're building a house together, an intergenerational house up in Westfield near where he lives. That house is finally underway and is expected to be ready in early June. We have to sell both of our houses in the meantime. That means our realtors are telling us we've got a 60-day window before we need to close on the other house, where we need to put our house on the market so that we'll have the money from those houses to close on the new house. And if you do the math backwards, that means we now have 2 weeks left to get our house and Dad's house ready to go on the market. It's crunch time. And so this past Monday, I sat down and I made a list of the things that we need to do to get both houses ready. This is the list that I came up with. Number one, organize, thin out, and pack 27 years worth of Christmas decorations that are stored in our basement. If you know my spouse David, you know he's a Mr. Christmas, and oh my goodness, you would not believe how many decorations we have in our basement. Jesus help us. Number two on the list, declutter the first floor of the house, because realtors always tell you, clear out the excess clutter, get the personal knickknacks and pictures off so that people walking in can see it as their house. Number three on the list, we need new carpeting upstairs. We have the original carpeting from the house upstairs, so it needs to be replaced, but that means we've got to get everything off the surface top so that the carpet people can move the furniture so that they can put down the new carpet. Number four, power wash the outside of the house. Number five, wash the windows. We've got a lot of windows. Number six, paint six rooms. Number seven, replace two dimmers inside the house and a timer on our outside pole lamp. Where are my lesbian friends when I really need you? I'm just saying. Number eight, deep clean the entire house. Number nine on the list, turn around and do the same thing at Dad's house. 2 weeks! I'm sitting there, I'm looking at this list, and I'm freaking out, and I'm feeling kind of like this. Or maybe like this. And I am literally paralyzed by stress. So I think, take your mind off this. So I sat down at my home desk, and I started thinking about doing a little advanced planning for today's sermon and meditating on this second petition, give us this day our daily bread. And it hit me like a ton of bricks, God's word for me today. God's saying to me, okay, Jeff, you've got a list, that's good. Future planning is good. But now what you need to do is prayerfully discern what's the next most important thing on that list that you can and should do today, then ask me for the strength to do that and to leave the rest to the next day and the next day and the next. And as soon as I did that, my sanity returned, the paralysis lifted, I was at peace and calm once again, and I was able to focus and have a really productive day getting something done instead of just being paralyzed by stress. Jesus, in the very last verse, in the same chapter where he gives us the Lord's Prayer, the very last thing Jesus says in that verse, Matthew 6:34, is, "Don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today." Yes, it's good to plan for the future, but today is the only day I can change. I can't change yesterday, and I can't control what happens tomorrow. But with God's help, I can change what happens today. So Jesus teaches us to pray, "God, help me to figure out what I most need to do today to address my single greatest stressor. Give me the strength to do that and to leave the rest for tomorrow." Thomas Carlyle was a famous historian who lived in the 1800s. He invested 2 years, two intensive years of his life into writing what he believed was going to be his masterpiece, a comprehensive history of the French Revolution. If you've ever tried to write something extensive, you know you got to get through writer's block and you got to get that inspiration and you work on the words to get them just right and you try this and you try that and you move it around till finally it's perfect. So 2 years he pours himself into this monumental task. Remember, in the 1800s, when you were creating a manuscript, you would write it out longhand on parchment paper. You wouldn't type it into your computer and then make multiple copies, and you couldn't take that parchment paper and take it to the copier to make a copy. So when he finished his manuscript, this was his one copy of his masterpiece. He entrusted that manuscript to his friend, also famous, John Stuart Mill, a British politician and philosopher. He entrusted the manuscript to him to read and to critique. So Mill took the manuscript home, sat it on a table, and while he was out of the room, his housekeeper came into the room needing to light a fire in the fireplace. She needed kindling to light the fire. She sees the rumpled pages just sitting there on the table, assumes it's trash, and she uses his manuscript to light the fire. Can you imagine? 2 years of pouring yourself into, and it literally goes up in smoke. When Mill told Carlyle what had happened, Carlyle was beside himself. His manuscript was the equivalent today of 895 pages. And he despaired of ever being able to recreate it the way it was. He was paralyzed by stress. He slumped into a depression. Until one day, as he was out walking around the town, he stopped and he watched for a while as some stone smiths were building a massive stone wall. And that's when he had a eureka moment. He sensed God's spirit saying to his spirit, "You see what they're doing here? Do you see how they're building this enormous wall? One stone at a time. Thomas, that's what you need to do. That's what you can do. Write, recreate one page per day, one day at a time." And it occurred to Thomas Carlyle, "I can do that." If he was looking at all that he had to do, overwhelming, impossible, paralyzed by stress. But when God's Spirit helped him break it down into a daily bite-sized chunk, he said, "Okay, I can do that. God, give me the strength to recreate one page today, and I'll leave the rest to tomorrow." And he rewrote, and probably made it better, his masterpiece. To this day, 200 years later, his work on the French Revolution is considered essential reading for anybody studying the French Revolution. Amazon, to this day, describes his masterwork this way. First published in 1837, this spectacular historical masterpiece has since been accepted as the standard work on the subject of the French Revolution. It combines a shrewd insight into character and a vivid realization of the picturesque and a singular ability to bring the past to blazing life, making it a reading experience as thrilling as any novel. All made possible because he heeded the wisdom of Jesus Christ. This is the second great petition that Jesus teaches us to pray, translated into our modern life and language. It would go something like this: help me figure out what I most need to do today in my area of greatest stress, and give me the strength to do that and to leave the rest for tomorrow. Focus on today. The troubles of today are enough for today. Live in the day. But to do that fully, there's something else Jesus bids us to also pray. And that brings us to the third great petition. Once again, our Papa who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. First petition, on earth as it is in heaven. Second petition, give us this day our daily bread. And then verse 12, the third petition, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, if you think about it, that is a strange way to ask for forgiveness for your sins, right? When I do something terrible that I feel ashamed of and I'm repentant, and I go to God to seek forgiveness, what I typically say is, God, please forgive me. But that's not how Jesus here is teaching us to confess our sins. Jesus teaches us to say, forgive us our debts, our sins, as we forgive our debtors, those who sin against us. In other words, he's teaching us to pray, God, please forgive me in the same way and to the same extent as I forgive those who sin against me. Do you dare pray that way? And if you do you stand forgiven, or does God have to say no can do until you forgive so-and-so? Who's that person in your life that you most struggle to forgive? Jeff, are you sure that Jesus is teaching us here that God's forgiveness of our sins is conditioned on our willingness to forgive those who sin against us? Because I'm not sure that's good theology. I'm absolutely sure that that's what Jesus meant. Because not only does he say it as the third petition in this prayer, but as soon as he says amen and finishes the prayer, guess what? In the next verse is the very next thing he says. He doubles back to this point and re-emphasizes it. He says in verse 14, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Papa will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Papa forgive your trespasses. Pretty clear, is it not? But why? Why would God make God's forgiveness conditional upon our willingness to forgive others? I can think of at least two possible reasons. First, the single greatest gift that any of us can ever give or receive is to be forgiven. If you've ever done something really horrible that really hurt somebody, but then they forgave you and let it go, and it was like it never happened, if you've ever experienced that, you know, oh, what a gift. It's the best gift anybody can ever receive. But God knows our reluctance to let go of the harm that others do to us and forgive them. And so it's almost as if God said, I need some leverage here to get them to do this. So it's almost as if God said, I know. I'll gladly forgive you if you gladly forgive those who sin against you, so as to incentivize us to do the very difficult thing that we try to avoid, forgiving those who sin against us. It's kind of like when you were a kid, you said, Mom, can I have a party here at the house for all my friends? And your mom said, sure, but you have to let your little sister participate. Oh, Mom, really? And Mom says, it's your choice. No party, or a party where you let your sister participate. Now, why would your mom do that? Is it because she doesn't love you? No, she loves you dearly. But she also loves your sister dearly, hard as that is to believe, and she wants your sister to also be able to share in the goodness of that moment. And so God says to us, I would be glad to forgive you of anything if you will gladly forgive those who sin against you. It's God incentivizing us, because the single greatest gift we could ever give or receive is the gift of forgiveness. Marianne Lieto tells how when she was a little girl, her dad, back in the day, as he came home each night, would empty out his pockets and put his spare change in a jar on a dresser in his bedroom. And as a little kid, as Marianne watched that jar of change fill up, to a kid, that was a lot of money. Money that she wished she had. Over time, it occurred to her, hey, I could probably take some of that money and Dad wouldn't notice. So one day she slips in and takes a nickel out and secrets it away. Dad comes home that night, doesn't notice the missing nickel, of course. So she figures, okay, this is working. I can do it again and again and again, so that over time, she accumulates quite a stash without Dad even noticing. But then she began to be convicted, to feel guilty. My dad loves me so much. He gives me so much. He blesses me so much. And here I am stealing from him. So smitten with guilt, as a little girl, she sat down and handwrote a note to her dad confessing what she had done, put it under the change, the jar of change, and next to it, put the pile of nickels that she had stolen. And then she waited for Dad to come home that night. She knew what she was in for. Serious violation. There was going to be serious punishment. But Dad came home that night, emptied his pockets, apparently didn't see the note. The next night he comes home, still nothing. The next night, still nothing. Before long, Marianne said, I kind of forgot about it. Until one day, out of the blue, he walks into her room and says, Marianne, I saw your note under the change jar. Her heart fell into her stomach. This was D-Day, Judgment Day. She just knew her dad was going to be furious and her punishment was going to be severe. Instead, she says, he began to tear up. He said, I'm so glad you told me. And then he gave her a really big hug, turned, and left the room. What? Is that it? It's over? She couldn't believe it. She says, he never mentioned it again. In her own words, she puts it this way. I stood there dumbfounded. I fully deserved my father's wrath. Why instead did he show mercy? I didn't deserve it. I hadn't earned it. This was my first powerful lesson on judgment and grace. Since then, I've never gotten over the way grace feels. Isn't that the truth? If you've ever really hurt somebody and they turned around and they forgave you freely and let it go like it never happened, you know what that feels like. Thank you. Thank you. God stands ready to forgive us like that. And he wants us to share that bounty of forgiveness with those around us. So God says, I'll gladly forgive you if you gladly forgive those who sin against you. But That's not the only reason why I think God says my forgiveness for you is conditioned on your willingness to forgive others. It's not just for the sake of those who sin against us, but it's also for our own sake. Because when I internalize my angry feelings towards somebody who has done me wrong, and I hang on to that, and I drag it around with me, it becomes a heavy burden to bear. God knows how reluctant we are to let things go, despite the fact that we desperately need, for our own sake, do so. A pastor was preaching one Sunday on the importance of forgiving others. So at one point during the sermon, the pastor asks everybody to stand up. They do so. Then the pastor says, anyone here who has an enemy or two or three, anyone here who has an enemy, sit down. Of course, everybody sat down, except one woman. 91-year-old Ellen Thomas remained standing. The pastor said, Ellen, 91 years of life, and you don't have an enemy on the planet? How is that possible? Come up here and tell us. So as Ellen gets up and slowly begins to make her way forward with her walker, everybody applauds. When she finally reaches the microphone, the pastor says, 91 years, not an enemy in the world. What's your secret? She smiled and said, I outlived every one of the SOBs. Not exactly the inspiration they were expecting, but so true to life. I'll never forgive you for what you did to me. If I live to be 91 years old, you're not getting off the hook. And then I end up dragging that around with me for how many decades of my life? Countless scientific medical studies, peer-reviewed, have documented the damage that we do to our bodies by carrying around resentment and unforgiveness. Peer-reviewed empirical studies have documented that people who struggle to forgive statistically on average have a higher heart rate than those who readily forgive, higher blood pressure, sleep less well, have a weaker immune system, and even jump less high. Seriously, if you can believe that, statistical large group of people who struggle to forgive, large group of people who readily found it fairly easy to forgive, a bunch of them, they test how high they can jump, and lo and behold, there's a statistical difference, statistical difference between the height that the forgivers and the unforgivers could jump. The lead author of one of the studies, Dr. Karen Swartz at Johns Hopkins Hospital, sums it up this way. There's an enormous physical burden to being hurt and disappointed and carrying that with you. The lead researcher on the Erasmus University study about how high people could jump summed it up this way. A state of unforgiveness is like carrying a heavy burden, a burden that victims bring with them when they navigate the physical world. If my refusal to forgive someone who has sinned against me does that much damage to my body, how much damage do you think it does to my spirit? And so a God of love says, look, you got to get serious about this. I'd love to forgive you. But what good does it do me to forgive you if you're going to drag around all that ick inside of you and break yourself down with your own unwillingness to forgive? I'll gladly forgive you, provided you will gladly forgive those who sin against you for your own sake. And so Jesus gives us this third petition translated into our modern life. Please forgive me for my sins to the same extent and in the same way I forgive those who sin against me. And please give me the strength to forgive so both they and I can be truly free. I'll close with this. Corrie Ten Boom and her sister Betsy and her parents lived in the Netherlands during World War II when the Nazis invaded. They felt, as a family, called by God to help hide Jews and help them to escape the Nazis into France or Great Britain. Over the course of time, they helped many Jews escape a near certain death until the Nazis found them out and they were arrested. The family was sent to various concentration camps. Corrie and her sister Betsy ended up at Ravensbrück concentration camp, where they endured terrible, horrific things. Ironically, it was in the concentration camp that Corrie found faith. Her sister Betsy was a devout follower of Jesus, and Corrie saw how Betsy's faith gave her strength amidst the most horrific circumstances, and she knew, I need what she's got. So she, Corrie, also became a devoted follower of Jesus. Corrie survived Ravensbrück. Betsy didn't. In the aftermath, Corrie felt called to travel around and share her story and emphasize to people the critical importance of giving and receiving the grace and the forgiveness of God. After she had shared her message in a church in, After she'd shared that message at a church in Munich one Sunday, as people were mingling, a man approached her. As soon as she saw his face, her blood froze. It was clear he didn't recognize her, but she recognized him. This was the cruelest guard she and Betsy had encountered at Ravensbrück. Approaching her now with a smile on his face, his hand outstretched, she says, I froze. I literally couldn't physically raise my hand to meet his. He said to her, Fraulein, what a wonderful talk. I got so much out of it. I'm so grateful that, as you said, God has buried our sins in the deepest sea. Betsy says, unable to lift my hand to his, I pretended to be fishing for something in my purse instead. I was suddenly, she says, coming face to face with the recognition that I, this person, who had been so glibly going around the world and telling people the importance of receiving and giving forgiveness, now, here I was, struggling to practice what I had been preaching. Undeterred, the man said to her, I heard you mention Ravensbrück. I was once a guard there. I did terrible things. But since then, I found Jesus. And I know God has forgiven me. But sister, it would mean so much to me if you too could forgive me. Corrie says, anger welled up inside of me, rage. Was my sister's life so cheap that you think you can walk up here to me and in a few words, it's as if it never happened? And yet she says at the same time, in my soul, I was hearing the words of Jesus. Forgive me my debts as I forgive my debtors. She says, I knew what I had to do, but I couldn't do it. So I silently prayed to God. I said, I reminded myself that forgiveness is not an emotion. It's an act of will. And so I said, okay, God, I will force myself to raise my hand to his, but you're going to have to do the rest. She reached out and took his hand, and in her own words, this is what happened. There was a current of electricity that started in my shoulder and raced down my arm and sprang into our joined hands. Then this healing warmth flooded my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. I found myself saying and meaning it, I forgive you, brother, with all my heart. For a long moment, we grasped each other's hands, the former guard and the former prisoner, finally set free. I had never known God's love so intensely as I did in that moment, but even then I realized it wasn't my love. I had tried and didn't have the power. This was the power of the love of God and of the Holy Spirit. Freely you've received, freely give. The prayers that Jesus teaches us to pray, they're not about getting more money or stuff or health or relationships or changing our circumstances. It's fine to ask for those things, but that wasn't Jesus' focus. Jesus knew that what we most need is to free our spirit so that we can make the most of whatever we face in life, because you can have ideal circumstances and still not thrive in life. What we most need to make the most of whatever life serves up to us is a spirit that is free and unencumbered. That's where it's at. And that's why Jesus taught us to pray, not my will, but yours be done. That's why Jesus taught us to pray, give us today our daily bread. Help me to figure out what I most need to do today to address the greatest stressor in my life, and give me the strength to do it and leave it to tomorrow. And that's why Jesus taught us to pray, please forgive me of my sins to the same extent and in the same way I forgive those who sin against me, and please give me the strength to forgive, so both they and I can be truly free. Jesus came to show us the way, the truth, and the life. This is the way he came to show us. Are we ready to live the wisdom of Jesus? God help us. Amen.